So hopefully you have found with me 1 Peter 4 and Revelation 20. And in 1 Peter 4, we're actually, well, let's tell you what, let's begin reading from verse 14, but then we will recap verses 12 and 13 from last Sunday as well, so we have a nice little running start as we conclude this section this week. 1 Peter 4, 14. If you are reproached for the name of Christ, blessed are you, for the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. On their part he is blasphemed, but on your part he is glorified. But let none of you suffer as a murderer, a thief, an evildoer, or a busybody in other people's matters. Yet if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in this matter. For the time has come for judgment to begin at the house of God, and if it begins with us first, what will be the end of those who do not obey the gospel of God? Now if the righteous one is scarcely saved, where will the ungodly and the sinner appear? Therefore, let those who suffer according to the will of God commit their souls to him in doing good, as to a faithful Creator. So if I can draw your attention back up to verse 12, and as we think about here this letter that Peter is writing to these churches, he is writing, of course, we've noted frequently, to communicate that, or to encourage them in the face of persecution that they are suffering, and further persecution that they will be suffering that is coming their way. So there's been these continual calls from Peter, these continual words of encouragement to his listeners about how they should be walking in purity, they should be walking in holiness, they should be walking in righteousness, that persecution is no excuse for their misbehavior, if you will. He speaks to them about encouraging them how they're to be relating to the non-believers that are around them, to continue to have loving hearts toward them, continuing to have servants' hearts toward them, continuing to have a perspective of being ministers to them. And here, really, in verses 12 through 19, chapter 5, which we'd be looking at next week, the letter takes a little bit of a different turn as Peter begins to wrap things up. So these are really kind of his final words on this subject of enduring persecution. And so final words are important. And so as we take a look at these, just to recap verses 12 and 13, if you'd look with me, please, he begins by saying, beloved, or those that are divinely loved, do not think it strange, alien, or foreign concerning the fiery trial, that smelting type of refining trial, which is in fact trying you. This should be in your notes from last week. As though some strange or alien or foreign thing has happened to you. But here's what you should be doing. Rejoice. Rejoice. Not because of your evil, but because of your good. Rejoice to the extent that you partake or share in Christ's sufferings. Not his suffering of the cross, but the same sufferings of persecution that Christ faced. Being marginalized, being pushed outside of the family, being written off as being a nut job, so to speak. Jesus endured these same sort of sufferings. Rejoice that you partake of those sufferings, that when his glory is revealed, you may also be glad with exceeding joy. The glory of the Lord Jesus is going to be revealed, and we are going to rejoice with him. And then beginning in verse 14, he says, if you're reproached for the name of Christ, blessed are you. Again, as you're taking note or writing in your Bible, you may want to circle that word if and write the word since, because that's the idea that it carries. Since you are being reproached for the name of Christ, blessed are you. Now, we want to be reminded about this word reproached again. The word reproached here, it means to be abused or upbraided. It means to be railed against or reviled. It means to be defamed. To be disparaged. If you are reproached, if you are defamed, if you're disparaged, if you're railed against, if you're reviled about, If you're abused or upbraided for the name of Christ, blessed are you. The phrase there, for a name of Christ, for the name of Christ, what he's referring to is for being a follower of Christ. Peter declares to us by the Holy Spirit that if you are reviled, if you're hated, if you're abused because of the name of Christ, because you are a Christian, because you don't just carry the name Christian, you don't carry it as a title, but you carry it as a lifestyle, and people hate you because of it, you're blessed. I wonder, you know, by that word reproached, could we put the word teased? I think we could. Since you are being teased for the name of Christ, blessed are you. Since you're being teased, oh, let the Christian do it. Oh, well, what does the Christian have to say today about this? Oh, do you have to go pray about it now? Oh, you Christians. Peter encourages us and he says, since you are being reproached for the name of Christ, blessed are you. The word blessed, we know that from the Beatitudes there in Matthew chapter 5. Blessed means to be happy or to be prosperous. What? You're telling me I'm being teased for the name of Christ, I'm being railed against and reviled for being a follower of the Lord Jesus Christ, and I am to be happy and to be prosperous in that? What could that possibly mean? Well, think about it like this. The very fact that you as a Christian receive persecution, it means that you are a spiritual Christian. It means that you're not only just a Christian in name, but you are a spirit-filled Christian. You are spiritually prosperous. You are so spiritually prosperous that the world looks out at you and they tease you. The world looks on at you and they abuse you. The world looks on at you and they rail you. Oh, do you really have to bring your Bible to work? Oh, it's break time. Susie's got to go read our Bible. The rest of us, well, we're going to sit around and do this, that, or the other thing. She's a Christian, don't you know? Wow. Peter encourages us, hey, the one who's spiritual enough in their Christian walk to receive persecution, not for being stupid, not for being arrogant, not for being worldly, not for being a jerk about your Christianity, but walking your Christianity in love and joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, and self-control, things that the world doesn't like. Wow, you're being persecuted for those things. You should be blessed. You should be happy. Check it out. I'm being persecuted for my love for Jesus because, check it out, this way, the worldly Christian, they don't suffer any persecution. Christian, do you know of any Christians like this? Maybe they're in your family. Maybe they work with you at your job or they're your neighbors. Oh, yeah, I'm a Christian. I go to thus and so church once in a while. And you look on at their life and their life doesn't look anything like Christ. And they don't seem to ever suffer any persecution. They get it together. They get along together with all the pagan neighbors. They get along together with all the worldly and ungodly people at work. They do the things they do. They behave the way that they behave. But they call themselves a Christian. But you know what? They're not happy. They're not prosperous. They're not spiritually blessed because they don't spiritually walk as a Christian and receive that enjoyment of knowing, hey, you know what, this is coming my way because I love Jesus. See, it's an amazing thing if we're one of those Christians that just kind of blends in, if we're one of those Christians that kind of looks like the rest of the world, you know what, we can slide right through, undercover Christian, no one will ever know about our love for the Lord, and we'll never grow. But if we're one of those Christians that, man, we're walking in the Spirit, we're Spirit-filled, we love Jesus, and it shows and it influences and affects every part of our life, know that the Spirit-filled Christian is the type of Christian that rubs the world the wrong way. It's the Spirit-filled Christian that grates on the nerves of the world. You're not even talking and you're bothering me. Just your presence being here. You just got that grin. You've got that joy. You've got that peace. Man, the rest of us, we sit around and we complain about the boss. We complain about the company. We complain about our managers. We complain about our vendors. We complain about our suppliers. We complain about our sales calls. And you never do any of those things. Yeah. See, that's it. And when you receive that, Peter says, hey, be encouraged. Be encouraged. If you are, since you are being reproached for the name of Christ, blessed are you. And then what I just taught you, he develops in the very next line. Look at this. Since you're being reproached for being a follower, for having the name of Christ, blessed are you. Why? For the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. The Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. The Spirit of glory, that is a beautiful title you want to have there for the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is the Spirit of glory. That Shekinah glory of God that made up that pillar of cloud and that pillar of fire that led the nation of Israel. The Shekinah glory of God that lived and dwelt there within the tabernacle with Israel. This is that Holy Spirit, the Spirit of glory. The Spirit of glory and of God. I've taken a little note here and I've put Trinity, because here in just this verse we have Christ mentioned, we have the Holy Spirit mentioned, and we have God the Father mentioned, all in one verse. Being a follower of Christ, the Spirit, the Holy Spirit of glory and of God, God the Father, rests upon you. Watch this. This little word rest. This word rest here, it means to refresh. In fact, this same word shows up, Jesus speaking, Matthew chapter 11, verse 28, when Jesus said, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Sometimes I think that what Jesus is saying, if I come to him and my labors and my heavy ladens, I'll give you rest, that he's just got a comfy chair for me. Think about it. A spiritual lazy boy. A place to kick up your feet and just enjoy life and living. And no. It's refreshment. Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. I'll give you refreshment. If you're being reproached for the name of Christ, blessed are you, for the Spirit of glory and of God rests or refreshes you. Come on, am I the only one who's thought about missionaries and Christians around the world who are undergoing more persecution than I will ever see in West Michigan in my entire life? Losing their family, losing their fingers, being broken at the knees, being beat outside the head, losing their jobs, their homes, their churches being burned down. Currently, as we speak, these things happening. Am I the only one that looks at that and goes, how do they survive that? How do they keep walking with the Lord? How do they get up and go another day? Man, I'd check out. No, you wouldn't. No, you wouldn't. Because if you're being reproached for the name of Christ, the Holy Spirit promises, blessed are you, for the Spirit of glory and of God is refreshing you. In fact, you ever seen those pictures? Gospel for Asia, Voice of the Martyrs. And they'll have this person, and there they are standing, a Christian, standing in front of their burned down house. Or there they are standing in front of their burned down church. Or the subheading says, you know, they lost all their family for Jesus Christ. And you look out at the picture, and you look at them, and they're just, it's a picture, but there's a glow about them. There's a joy about them. They've been rested, and they've been refreshed in the Lord. If you ever get the opportunity, and I meant to mention it a couple weeks ago, and I think I forgot. Sometimes I get talking so fast, I blow right past things I've got written down to mention to you. But if you've never read a book called Fox's Book of Martyrs, now there's something great about this book I'm going to tell you about in a minute. Fox's Book of Martyrs, it's a compendium, it's a collection of stories of people who have given their life as martyrs for the Lord Jesus Christ from the time of Jesus So the story of the disciples and the apostles, how they gave up their lives, all the way up to, I want to say, like the 18th century, people being burned at the stake and this sort of thing. I hope I have the timing right. Incredible stories. Now, here's what's great about Fox's Book of Martyrs. It's free. All you have to do is go to calvarychapelriverside.com, click on resources, and a drop-down box will appear. Click on books, and a window will open up, and there's a whole bunch of PDF books there that are available for free, and you can read it on your computer, on your smartphone, on your tablet. Kind of sound like a commercial. Fox's Book of Martyrs. Time and time again in these stories, as people are being burned at the stake, as people are being laying their head down underneath the guillotine, the glory of God appears upon their face. There's a rest and a refreshment that can only come from the power of the Holy Spirit. If you reproach for the name of Christ, blessed are you, for the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. On their part, on the part of the world, on the part of non-believers, He, the Lord, the Spirit of glory, the Holy Spirit, is blasphemed. Unbelievers, they blaspheme the Holy Spirit of God, the unpardonable sin. They blaspheme the Spirit of God. On their part, He's blasphemed, but on your part, Christian, the Holy Spirit's glorified. Hey, non-believers, when they reproach you, when they revile you, when they tease you, when they abuse you, they blaspheme the work of the Holy Spirit in their life. But when you don't respond like the world, when you don't respond with the sticks and the stones, when you don't respond with the words, the Holy Spirit is glorified. But could I just make a note, Peter says, verse 15, but let none of you suffer as a murderer, a thief, an evildoer, or as a busybody in other people's matters. So Peter, as he is writing along here, beginning to wrap up his thoughts on this idea of enduring persecution and glorifying the Lord through it, he says, hey, if you're being reproached for the name of Christ, blessed are you, the Spirit of glory and of God rests upon you. On the part of the world, the Holy Spirit blasphemed, but on your part, Christian, Holy Spirit's glorified, but wait a minute. Let none of you followers of the name of Jesus, let none of you suffer, and the connection is suffer reproach. Let none of you be abused. Let none of you be teased. Let none of you be reviled. Let none of you be defamed. Let none of you be disparaged as a murderer, a thief, or an evildoer. I think it's interesting. The tense there that's used, the word tense that's used there for let none of you, is the word tense, let none of you as a habit. Don't let it be a habit, Christian, that you would suffer reproach as a murderer, a thief, an evildoer. Hopefully there are no Christians out there that are, you know, habitually being murderers or habitually being thieves. But we know that spiritually Jesus said about murderer, if you even look on at your brother with anger in your heart, you've already committed murder. So that's the idea here, not a habitual murderer, killing people. Hey, don't be a thief. Don't be a habitual evildoer, Christian. No. Let none of you suffer reproach as a murderer, a thief, or an evildoer. Watch this. Here's the point of application, Christian. Very important. Persecution is no excuse for lawlessness. Persecution is no excuse for lawlessness. I'm so tired of my boss teasing me for being a Christian. I'm taking this stapler home. This is my stapler. It sits on my desk every day. I use it every day. I love this stapler. And I happen to need a stapler at home. He owes it to me. He persecutes me as a Christian. You know the greatest thing stolen from companies is office supplies? Millions and millions and millions of dollars a year stolen from the company. Office supplies. Post-it notes. Little snap clips, rolls of tape, staplers. No. Let none of you Christians suffer reproach as a murderer, a thief, an evildoer. Persecution is no excuse for lawlessness. Persecution is no excuse for lawlessness. I'm sorry to tell you that Martin Luther King is not the standard for righteousness. If you knew his personal life, you would certainly believe that. Civil disobedience, you cannot find it in God's word. Persecution is no excuse for lawlessness. Just because you're persecuted for being a Christian, just because you're persecuted for righteousness' sake, just because you're persecuted for doing well, does not mean that you're given a license to be lawless. This is what this text declares. I thought about this. Persecution is no excuse for lawlessness, and maybe your mind is kind of taking off to different parts of our country and behaviors that we've seen over the last couple weeks. And that's an accurate assessment to make in some cases. We have certain people called reverend out there, just stoking the flaming fires of lawlessness. And that's easy to do. But this morning I want to turn to A.W. Tozer and I want to put a little bit finer point on this concept of persecution is no excuse for lawlessness, as he talks about sins of character. Character sins are fully as injurious to the Christian cause as the more overt acts of wickedness. Character sins are as many as the various facets of human nature. Just so there may be no misunderstanding, let us list a few of them. Sensitiveness, irritability, churlishness, fault-finding, peevishness, temper, resentfulness, cruelty, uncharitable attitudes, and of course, he says there are many more. These kill the spirit of the church and slow down any progress which the gospel may be making in the community. Many persons who had been secretly longing to find Jesus Christ have been turned away and embittered by manifestations of ugly character flaws in the lives of the very persons who were trying to win them to Jesus. Unsaintly saints are the tragedy of Christianity. People of the world usually pass through the circle of disciples to reach Christ. And if they find those disciples severe and sharp-tongued, they can hardly be blamed if they sigh and turn away from him. Peter says, Christian, let none of you suffer reproach as a murderer, a thief, or an evildoer. Because you're persecuted, because you're hammered by your neighbor or by your family for your love for Jesus, there is no excuse, there's no call for lawlessness on your part or mine. And let's be cautious here that when we think about law, we don't think about the Ten Commandments, or we don't think about the law that says, do not steal office supplies from your office. But how about if we think about this law? The law to love the Lord your God with all of your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And your neighbor as yourself. See, to violate those laws because we have been persecuted, that would be lawlessness. There's no excuse for lawlessness in the face of persecution. And if we say, okay, well, I'm not going to be lawless, what's the extreme that we could swing to? Hey, if I'm not going to act like the world, when they act really cold toward me, when they're really mean to me, when they're really rude to me, what's the other extreme that we could swing to? Well, Peter notes it here in verse 15. Let none of you suffer as a murderer, a thief, or an evildoer, or as a busybody in other people's matters. Busybody in other people's matters. Let me give you some background information here. Let me read some verses to you. This word that we have here for busybody, it shows up in three other places for us. I'll read them to you. Luke 12, then one man from the crowd said to Jesus, Teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me. But Jesus said to him, Man, who made me a judge or an arbitrator over you? In other words, Jesus says, hey, don't pull me into your civil litigation. I'm not here to judge matters of who owns what and when and, you know, who what belongs to who. I'm here for spiritual purposes. 1 Thessalonians 4, we urge you, brethren, Paul writes, that you increase more and more, that you also aspire, Christian, to lead a quiet life, to mind your own business, and to work with your own hands as we commanded you, that you walk properly toward those who are outside, that you may lack nothing. Oh, mind your own business. 2 Thessalonians 3:11, Paul says again, for we hear that there are some who walk among you in a disorderly manner, not working at all, but are busybodies. So we bring our attention back over to Peter. Hey, one extreme, let none of you suffer as a murderer, a thief, and an evildoer. There's no excuse for lawlessness. Swing to the other extreme where we don't want to be. What is that extreme? Or be a busybody. Watch this. Here's a synonymous word. Or a meddler. M-E-D-D-L-E-R. A meddler in other people's matters. Watch this. What Peter is referring to is Christians interfering in the lives of Gentiles, zealous to conform them to Christianity. See, here's what happens. At one extreme, I can't break God's law because you're persecuting me. I have to love God and I have to love you as my neighbor. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to swing to the other extreme and I'm going to be a busybody, a meddler in your life, and I'm going to conform you to Christianity. I'm going to stand there and I'm going to say, well, you may get on me because I'm a Christian, but let me tell you, you're going to hell because you've done this. You're going to burn forever because you do that. And if you don't want to burn forever, then you need to be a Christian like me. You need to conform to my rules, my principles, my righteousness. You get it? On one hand, I can't fight back. Hey, you're persecuting me, so I'm going to be a thief. I'm going to be an evildoer. No. Not allowed to do that. Other extreme. Okay, since I can't do that extreme, I'll do this extreme. I'm going to make all of you in my company Christians. I'm going to make all of you in my family Christians, whether you like it or not. I'm going to shove the Bible down your throat. You're going to do devotions with me, whether you like it or not. I'm going to force you. I'm going to conform you to Christianity. And how am I going to do that? I'm going to do that by being a busybody in your life. I'm going to do that by being a meddler in your life. You can't mow your lawn on Sunday afternoon. You can't do that. You can't do this. You have to give that. You have to serve in this way. You need to be a Christian. Do it my way. Now watch this. You can't conform people to Christianity. What needs to happen is they need to be converted. They can't be conformed. They need to be converted. We have spent years within our country and the political process seeking to elect politicians that will conform the culture to Christianity without converting them. So what we're going to do is we're going to pass laws, we're going to make policy that conform the culture to Christianity. That is directly opposite of what God's Word has to say. You never once see Jesus, Paul, Peter, James, John, anybody saying, you know what, somebody just needs to go to Rome, and they need to pass some laws, and we need to get Caesar on our side, and you know what, we just need a Christian Caesar, and then everything's going to be okay. This is what we need to do. You never read it once. You will not read it once. Because righteousness is not found in conforming a culture to the standards of Christianity. Righteousness is found in converting one person at a time to the kingdom of God. In the same way, a Christian is not made by conforming one to church. A Christian is made by a person being born again by God's Holy Spirit and them coming to church because they want to be with God's people. They want to study His Word. They want to worship His name. One commentator says this, Christians from mistaken zeal under the plea of faithfulness, might readily step out of their own calling and make themselves judges of the acts of unbelievers. hey, let me tell you, you're a sinner. You know, it's a pretty amazing thing. All the sinners I've talked to through the years since I got saved in 1992 and baptized in the Holy Spirit in 97 and started doing evangelism and witnessing to people, I really have not had to spend a lot of time convincing people they're sinners. Most people know they're sinners. Or if they don't know, it's pretty easy to get them to the place to see that they're sinners. And to tell them that they're going to hell, well, hey, what about we tell them that there's a way to heaven? Let's seek not to conform them, but to convert them to the Lord Jesus Christ. Let none of you suffer as a murderer, a thief, an evildoer, or as a busybody in other people's matters. Yet, if anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in this matter. This is kind of a fascinating little verse that we have here. Yet if anyone suffers as a Christian, or if anyone suffers because he is a Christian, that's what it's saying. If you suffer because you're a Christian, that's the idea of as a. Yet if anyone suffers as a, or because he is a Christian, let him not be ashamed. And it's interesting that Peter would use the word Christian here in this place. Do you know that him using the word Christian here in this place, that's not meant to be a blessing, so to speak? It's not meant to be a blessing. In fact, the word Christian only shows up in the Bible three times. Only three times the word Christian shows up in the Bible, and of course, all of them in the New Testament. Once here in Peter, twice in Acts. I'll read the Acts passages to you. Acts 11:26. So it was that for a whole year they assembled with the church and taught a great many people, and the disciples were first called Christians in Antioch. They were called Christians. They didn't call themselves Christians. Hey, here we are getting together for this Bible study. We're followers of Jesus Christ. What do we call ourselves? I know. We'll call ourselves Christians. No, that is not at all what happened. More on that in a moment. Acts 26:28 gives us further insight. Then Agrippa said to Paul, "You almost persuade me to become a..." I can almost imagine him saying it in this way. "You almost persuade me to become a Christian." You know, it's like Brussels sprouts, Christian, liver and onions, Christian. I'm going to get a liver and onion eater. I just know it. I don't want to hear. I've been delivered from that. I'm over 18. My mom loved me. She wanted to bless me. You almost persuade me to become a Christian. See, Christians in the early church, their preference to refer their preference for a title was brethren, or saints, or followers of the way. That shows up in the book of Acts too, the way. And Christian wasn't a title they took for themselves. Christian was a smear that was placed upon them. Christian was a title that was placed upon them that was meant to differentiate them from the rest of the world, to look down at them. In fact, watch this. In Rome, the leader of Rome, the Roman Empire, was known as the Caesar. In Greek, it would be, I'm not quite sure how to pronounce it, but it would be like, it's K-A-I-S-A-R, Kaiser, maybe. And those who were followers of Caesar, the Kaiser, they were known as Kaisianos. I ain't doing that again. You just get it once. So people who followed this Messiah, who came out of Judaism, this Messiah, Christ, Christianos, they were members not of Caesar's party, not of the Republican Party, not of the Democratic Party, not of the Green Party or the Independent Party. They were a member of Christ's party. They were a sect, a religious sect, considered by the Romans to be a religious sect or section of Judaism, this political, religious, not right, not political, this religious party that instead of following Caesar, were following this guy named Christ, who was a nut. We crucified him, AD 33, and they somehow think that he was resurrected 3 days later. Yeah, like we're going to believe that, those little Christians. Am I making myself clear in terms of how the title is used? I hope. I got nothing else to give you. If anyone suffers as a Christian, not one who worships the Caesar of Rome, but one who worships the Christ of Christianity. If anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him, in the tense here, you want to take note in your Bible, the tense is let him, as in let him keep on, is the idea, let him and let him and let him and let him and let him glorify God in this matter. What matter? Suffering as a Christian. Do you see that there in the text? If anyone, if any of you Christians suffer as a Christian, suffering reproach, abuse, being upbraided, railing, reviled, defamed, disparaged, teased. If any one of you suffers as a Christian carrying that title, don't throw the title off. If any of you suffers as a Christian, don't be ashamed of this name. Don't be ashamed of this negative stereotype. Don't distance yourself from it. I'm going to ask you a question, and I want you to shout out the answer. Who's writing this letter? Mark chapter 14, verse 67. And when she saw Peter warming himself, she looked at him and said, "You also were with Jesus of Nazareth." But Peter denied it, saying, "I neither know nor understand what you are saying." And Peter went out on the porch, and a rooster crowed. And the servant girl saw him again and began to say those who stood by, this guy right here, this is one of them. But Peter denied it again. And a little later, those who stood by said to Peter again, "Surely you are one of them, for you are a Galilean." Jesus was from Galilee. "And your speech shows it." Then Peter said, "Ha, you totally got me. Yep, you're right. Man, I love Jesus. I am a Christian. I'm a follower of his. Let me just tell you about the pathway to salvation. You know what's going to happen here? He's going to be crucified in just a short period of time, but on the third day he's going to arise. And if you believe in him, that he's the substitutionary atonement for your death, or for your sin and his death, then so too you can be a part of his glorious resurrection, and you too will never taste death." No, Peter didn't do any of those things. They said to him, "Surely you are one of them, for you are a Galilean, and your speech shows it." And Peter began to curse and swear and say, "I do not know this man of whom you speak." That's this Peter writing this letter that says, if any one of you suffers reproach as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him keep on glorifying God in this manner. See, on the day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit was poured out upon Peter. He was baptized in the Holy Spirit, and he was given a boldness by the Spirit of God to be a witness from Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the outer ends of the earth. No more denials of Jesus. No more denials of being a Christ follower, being of the Christ party. No way! Now Peter stands with Jesus. Peter writes this letter, and he encourages. These Christians. If anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify God in this matter. F.B. Meyer says, this is true whether it means the loss of business you and I would never hide our Christianity to keep an account, would we? To make a sale? To keep a customer? F.B. Meyer says this is true whether it means the loss of business, reputation, and home, desertion by parents. None of us would ever keep our Christianity quiet, would we? So we could keep that relationship with our parents calm, and good, peaceful. Because my parents have said if they ever hear that word Christian again, they're cutting me off. F.B. Meyer says this is true whether it means the loss of business, reputation, and home, desertion by parents, children. Would I ever follow Jesus so closely I'd be willing to lose my children and friends? Misrepresentation, hatred, and even death? Would I die for being a part of Christ's party? If anyone suffers as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but let him glorify or keep on glorifying God in this matter of suffering as a Christian. For the time, verse 17, has come for judgment to begin at the house of God. And if it begins with us first, what will be the end of those who do not obey the gospel of God? Peter says the time has come for judgment to begin at the house of God. The church is being judged. The church is being persecuted by the world. Right now. You know, it's an interesting thing in our country. The persecution of the church ebbs and flows. Well, I'm no wise owl. I have not been around the block. In fact, I've only got a 14-year start around the block in terms of being in ministry. But what I've watched is our government takes three steps forward in terms of persecuting or controlling the church. One step back. Three steps forward, one step back. The latest persecution was the Affordable Care Act in terms of how it affected nonprofit organizations of which churches are. In terms of how it put churches and Christian organizations in a place where they had to make a decision whether they wanted health care or they wanted to fund abortion. And I won't climb on my soapbox, but I'm just here to tell you that if you don't think your church is being persecuted for being a church, got another thing coming. And this is nothing compared to what's happening in other parts of the world. Absolutely nothing. See, persecution, trial, challenge, and difficulty from the world, it's at the house of God right now, in Peter's day and in this day. And if it, verse 17, if it, this judgment, begins with us Christians first, what will be the end of those who do not obey the gospel of God? In other words, what Peter says, if believers are suffering this much right now, in this day and age, for righteousness' sake, how much more suffering will there be for those who choose unrighteous lies? Think about it, Christian. If the enemy can reach the church, and if the enemy can reach us Christians to the extent that he is today, where Christians are rounded up and massacred in other parts of the country, churches are burned down, and atrocities one after the other, which we don't have to notate here this morning. If that can happen in this day and age, where we're at right now, to us as believers who have the protection and the guidance and the Holy Spirit within us and around us, who the promise of God has been, hey, the gates of hell will never overtake the church. We have that promise. Hey, how much worse is judgment going to be for those who have rejected Jesus, who have rejected the good news of the salvation of the Lord? What will be the end of those who do not obey the gospel of God? It's going to be terrible. It's a motivator for us as believers to share the good news of the gospel. If we suffer this persecution as Christians right now, what stands in front of them? And they can't even see the freight train coming. We look forward to an eternity of heaven. They have coming for them an eternity of hell. Jesus says, not me say, not a theologian say, Jesus says, the fires will not be quenched. Their worm, the inner essence of who they are as individuals, will not die. In the same way that heaven is endless, in the same way that heaven is glorious, so too hell in the lake of fire is endless and the opposite of glorious, whatever that is. Hey, the time has come for judgment to begin at the house of God. If it begins with us first, what will be the end of those who do not obey the gospel of God? Now, then he quotes from Proverbs 11:38, quoting Old Testament, to buttress his argument, to buttress his communication to his readers. He says, now, if the righteous one is scarcely saved, where will the ungodly and the sinner appear? And here's what the text is saying. If the righteous one is scarcely saved, the word scarcely there, we don't use this word in this way anymore, but it means with difficulty. If the righteous one is saved with difficulty. I don't know about you, but I didn't come to salvation and just the blink of an eye. It was a wrestle. It was a tussle. I wanted to be free from my sin, but what was it going to mean? It was going to mean the end of my bottle. It was going to mean the end of my friends. It was going to mean the end of my ungodly ways. It was going to mean the end of my unethical practices. And it was going to mean the end of a whole lot of other things that I didn't even know anything about. But I knew it was going to mean the end of those things. It was a struggle. And it was a struggle not just within me, it was a struggle within the heavenlies and within the world around me, as there was a fight between lightness and darkness, as there was a fight between good and evil for my very soul. If the righteous one is saved with difficulty, and then he talks about two individuals here, the ungodly and the sinner. The ungodly is one who has no regard for God. No regard for God. The individual who is an agnostic. Hey, God's out there, but there's no way you can know him. He's out there. I believe that God exists, but there's no way to get to him. The atheist, who there's actually very few of in the world, I don't believe that God exists at all. The ungodly, the person who has no regard for God whatsoever, where will the ungodly and the sinner? The sinner here is the individual, the person who is sin-loving, the person who is dedicated to evil. The person who is the orientation about their life is rebellion to God. Hey, if the righteous one is saved with difficulty, where will the ungodly and the sinner appear? Appear? Oh, watch this. It becomes a second to the last point of application as we begin to wrap up, because I want us to understand that the idea of judgment, if you will, the arc of judgment intersects the timeline of life and living twice. The arc of judgment intersects that timeline twice. The first place that judgment intersects that timeline is at the cross of Calvary. Jesus took our judgment, took the judgment for sin upon himself there at the cross. That's one place that judgment crosses that timeline. The second place that judgment crosses the timeline is at the great white throne judgment. See, at the cross, judgment, well, there was suffering temporarily. For a few hours, all hell poured out its fury on Jesus as he hung there on Calvary's tree, taking the judgment for the sin of the world. His suffering was temporary. His suffering was substitutionary. I will never suffer for my sin. I will never be judged for my sin. Judgment for my sin, suffering for my sin, speaking of eternal suffering, took place there at the cross of Calvary. Done. But over here, where that ark of judgment intersects the timeline again, there at the great white throne judgment, there, as non-believers, those who have rejected Jesus, those who have blasphemed the Holy Spirit, they stand before the great white throne of judgment, and there, as they are judged for the rejection of Jesus, they will suffer eternally for that judgment. Suffering temporarily for my salvation, suffering eternally for rejection of Jesus. Those are the only two judgments. Watch, I ask you to turn to Revelation 20, if you'd look there with me, please. You're familiar with it. We don't have to parse it. We'll read down through it. John says, I saw a great white throne, verse 11, and Jesus sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, this would be the spiritually dead, verse 12, Revelation 20. I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and books were opened. And another book was opened, which is the book of life, and the dead were judged. Look at this. Have you ever noticed this before? According to their works. Hey, you say to somebody, hey, are you going to heaven? I certainly hope so. I'm a pretty good guy. Well, why do you think Jesus would let you into his heaven? Well, I volunteer at the hospital once a week. I go to church on Christmas and Easter. I do this, I do that, I've got all these good works. Oh, no. The dead were judged according to their works by the things which were written in the books. And you know what? The sea gave up the dead who were in it, and death and Hades delivered up the dead who were in them, and they were judged, these individuals, these non-believers, these pagans, these rejectors of Jesus, were judged, each one according to his works. And then death and Hades, they were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. That's the end. That's the judgment that awaits for those who say, no, I don't need Jesus. I'm going to do it my way. In fact, I have a theme song. No. No, you want to be in that place of a Christian who says, my sin was judged at the cross of Calvary. Jesus took my judgment. I'll never face judgment again because I belong to him. If the righteous one is saved with difficulty, I'm back in 1 Peter 4, where will the ungodly and the sinner appear? They'll appear at judgment before the great white throne. They'll have to answer for their works. They'll have to answer for their deeds. They'll have to answer for the rejection of Jesus. Therefore, flowing out of that, as a result of that, in conclusion, let those who suffer according to the will of God, and those are the people we've been talking about down through all of these verses, these Christians who are suffering reproach for the name of Christ, these believers and the followers of the Lord that Peter's writing to in his day and in ours, therefore let those who suffer according to the will of God, watch this, this is a grand and glorious finale, don't miss it, because really, in my perspective, this is the finale to the entire letter, and it just gets better, watch this. I'm so excited I can't even talk. Therefore, let those who suffer according to the will of God commit their souls to him in doing good as to a faithful creator. Therefore, let those who suffer, and we've talked a dozen times about this throughout the letter, let those who suffer according to the will of God. This is where we say, let those who suffer not for being stupid, not for being arrogant, not for being a big jerk, let those who suffer according to the will of God, because of their love for Jesus, because they're walking in the fruit of the Spirit, because they're Spirit-filled, empowered, and enabled by God's Holy Spirit, let those who suffer according to the will of God commit their souls to God. That word commit, would you please circle that, and would you please write this word next to it? Deposit. Or you could write this word in trust. This is the word that Jesus used on the cross, Luke 23:46, when he said to God his Father, "Into your hands I commit my spirit." Jesus the Son said to God the Father, "Into your hands I commit, I deposit," as one would make a deposit into a bank for safekeeping, "I deposit," or "I entrust," as one would share a secret with a trusted friend, knowing that it will be kept, "I commit, I deposit, I entrust my spirit into your hands. Therefore, let those who suffer according to the will of God commit." Now it gets better. The word "commit," the tense, is a present continuous. Let those who suffer according to the will of God deposit, entrust, commit, deposit, entrust, commit, deposit, entrust, commit, deposit, entrust, commit, over and over and over and over again, deposit, entrust, commit their souls, that which makes me me. Not the balding old guy that you see on the outside. That's not me. It's the hairy guy on the inside that loves the Lord, that's going to live forever. That guy, the soul, what makes me me and not me you and not you me, the soul. Those who suffer according to the will of God deposit, entrust, commit continuously their souls to God. Look at this. In doing good. So, not only entrust yourself to God, but do good. Deposit your soul continuously with God and do good. Trust Him to do good. Always do the good thing. Never do the bad thing. Never, ever, 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 ever. We could go off on a whole tangent about what sin is. In fact, I think we talked about that on Wednesday night. How about sin is basically saying to God, "I know better than you in this case. I know what your word says. I just don't want to do it because I know better." No, don't do that. Let those who suffer according to the will of God commit their souls to Him in doing good. We're almost at the peak. Here it comes. As to a faithful, this is the God who said, "I will never leave you or forsake you." Commit your soul to Him in doing good as to a faithful. Look at that last word. Creator. How crazy is that? As to a faithful creator? We're not in the book of Genesis. We're not talking about creating anything. Why is he finished with creator? That's got to be a copyist error. Doesn't he want to say, commit their souls to Him and doing good as to a faithful father? I mean, that even has a little alliteration to it. Faithful father. I like that. Faithful father. Faithful creator? Creator's back in Genesis. We're in Peter. We're undergoing persecution. Life is difficult. We're suffering for being Christians. Why are we going back to Genesis? Let me tell you a story. I love Lego. When I was growing up, I had we used to call it a train case. I think they call it a makeup case. It was a hard shell little piece of luggage like this. Lid flips up, mirror inside. Whole thing packed full of Lego. It was never enough. And I made a commitment within my heart that if I ever had kids, man, have we got Lego. But there's a problem. I have a progeny that makes things out of Lego and then doesn't want to take them apart. So we have all kinds of Lego things sitting all over the place, but the Lego boxes are nigh unto empty. If I want to go build something, I still have no Lego to work with because all the good pieces are taken and most of the bad pieces as well. You know what? The one who builds with the Lego, he is the creator of that which he has made out of Lego. And the Creator has the choice to be faithful to that Lego piece. I will never take you apart. I'll never make you into something else. I am going to protect you. I am going to, watch this word because you're going to need it in a minute. I'm going to preserve you because I am the Creator of you Lego brilliance. And so you're just going to be there and you're going to gather dust and you're going to be mine and it's going to be glorious because I'm the Creator and I get to say what happens with you. Because it's my Lego, it's my creation, and I created you. That's God. That is a faithful Creator. God looks on at the difficulties, the trials, and the challenges that we face following Him as born-again believers in Jesus Christ. And He says, therefore, let those who suffer according to the will of God continuously commit their souls to me in your well-doing as a Christian, because I'm the faithful Creator. And if you'd please do me a favor, because I want you to remember the Lego illustration, next to the word Creator, would you please write this word preserve? Or preserver. And now here's the bonus. No extra points, no additional letter grades at the end of the marking period, but your socks are going to get blessed off this week. In fact, if you do this and you get blessed, shoot me an email because I want to hear about it. Look up in your concordance the word preserve or preserver. And we're really kind of focused on the Old Testament. Now remember, the Creator, He's the one who is, He's the preserver. He's the one, the Bible says, the Creator, He holds all things together. He holds the creation in the palm of His hand. He's the Creator. He built it. He can take it apart, but He can also preserve and protect it. You're going to go through a concordance, not the one in the back of your Bible. Use a computer program or a real concordance, and look up the usages of the word preserve or preserver, and tell me what you find. Because see, for Peter writing this, and for those that were reading this letter, they would have known exactly what he was alluding to. And they would have said, yes, and amen. See, watch this. One commentator has said this: God is the Creator of everything, including the situation in which you're suffering. Nothing can happen that God doesn't allow. He's the Creator of the person to whom you're married, the person with whom you work, and the neighbor by whom you live. He's the Creator of every situation. And guys, here comes the period at the end of the sentence. Because He's the Creator, He is in control. Commit yourself to the Creator who's in control. Do you see it? The three C's. Commit yourself to God the Father, who is the Creator. And because He's the Creator, He's in control and He will preserve you. Watch this. Let's bow our head. Let's close our eyes with this. We'll close in prayer. Truly my soul silently waits for God. From Him comes my salvation. He only is my rock and my salvation. He is my defense. I shall not be greatly moved. How long will you attack a man? You shall be slain, all of you, like a leaning wall and a tottering fence. They only consult to cast him down from his high position. They delight in lies. They bless with their mouth, but they curse inwardly. My soul, wait silently for God alone. For my expectation is from Him. He only is my rock and my salvation. He is my defense. I shall not be moved. And God is my salvation and my glory. The rock of my strength and my refuge is in God. Trust in Him at all times, you people. Pour out your heart before Him. God is a refuge for us. Surely, men of low degree are a vapor. Men of high degree are a lie. If they are weighed on the scales, they are altogether lighter than vapor. Do not trust in oppression, nor vainly hope in robbery. If riches increase, do not set your heart on them. God has spoken once, twice I have heard this, that power belongs to God. Also to you, O Lord, belongs mercy, for you render to each one according to his work. And we close with the words of the Apostle Paul writing to Timothy, who said, "And the Lord will deliver me from every evil work and preserve me for his heavenly kingdom. To him be glory forever.